The more videos we pump out, the more engagement and interaction and comments and questions we see, and we absolutely love it. They are tremendous for adding to our ideas list of what videos we should make. Now, lately we've seen a couple of questions around the scoring, the traditional scoring versus the NCA scoring, and some of the inner workings of that. So that's what we're going to dig into in this video. We're going to get right back to the basics of how the points work regardless of your scoring system, and then we'll dig into the different scoring options and the pros and cons of each. Let's take a look. Jeremy Tracy here with Tracy Crokinole Boards. If you find this helpful, please go ahead, give us a like, a comment, a subscribe, share this with your friends, share this with the people you wish were your Crokinole friends, and just help spread the word of the greatest game on earth. Now, we're gonna go right back to the basics and talk about how the scoring regions work on the board. If you already know that, feel free to skip ahead. But for the brand new people out there, because there's more and more people getting started and getting introduced with the game, we're going to cover the most basics of the point regions on the board. The further in toward the center you get, the more it is worth. This most outer ring at the end of the round, that's when you're gonna count points, is at the end of the round. Anything that is in this outermost region is going to be worth 5 points. Moving in one ring, if you're anywhere within this ring, it is going to be worth 10 points. There's a pattern here. Come within this innermost circle, and it is worth 15 points. Again, we're gonna count these at the end of the round. If you are skilled or lucky, depending on your perspective, enough to drop one into the center, you do not leave it there. You pull it out and put it into your handy dandy 20 holder, and that will get counted at the end of the round as, you guessed it, 20 points. Another point of clarification within how the points work is these dividing lines. It's a common question we hear. What if it's in, you know, what if it's touching two regions, the 5 and the 10? What if it's more in the 10 or more in the 5? Very, very simple what the rule is. If it is even touching a line, it counts as the lower point region. And it's not how it looks from above, it is how it looks from the side. So when you look from the side, some people get serious enough, they take a flashlight and they look in this way. If you can see any plane between the button and the line, then it's fully in that region. But if it's even just barely touching the line between the 5 and the 10, it counts as the lower region. And when you are playing the game, if a button ends up, not if it crosses and comes back, that's another rule altogether, where it ends up is what we want to look at. If it even ends up touching this outer line, we are going to take it and put it into the gutter because it's touching the line, it's worth the lower point region, it's worth 0 points, but the reason we remove it is we don't want it to interfere with any future shots. So here we go, it's 5, 10, 15, 20. If it's touching any point region, any dividing line, it counts as the lower point value. There's your points. Now, what most people grew up playing Crokinole with is what we would call traditional scoring. There's so many people say, oh, I used to play this at the cottage with my grandma and my grandpa. This is probably the style of scoring that they used. So let's say the round is over. At that point, you are going to tally up all points on the boards. And it's the same whether you're playing singles, where you sit directly across from your opponent, or if you play doubles, where you sit across from your partner and your opponents sit opposite each other. When everyone has shot all of their discs and the round is done, you're going to tally up the points using the regions that we just described. Now, with traditional scoring, you're going to add up all the point values of the red points as well as all the point values of any of the black points. So the first thing you can do is any that are touching a line, if you move them into that lower region, just so that it's clear. After that, what I'd recommend you do is you start canceling points out. So if you've got a red and a black that are both in the 5, you just take those and you eliminate them from the board. It just makes your math simpler. To one of each in the 10, you eliminate those, makes your points easier. One of each in the 15, eliminate those. All we're left with is the 15 black points on the board. Again, if there were any 20s, they would come in. They would factor into your math. But in this example right here, we've canceled all points out that are equal, and what we're left with is the 15 black points. at which point on your score pad, the black team would gain 15 points. Now, the next time around, let's say, you know what, the red team has two 20s and the black team has 25 points on the board. So you take 40 for red minus the 25 that black has, and that leaves the red team with 15 points. Therefore, on your score, it is now 15 for black and 15 for red, because your points carry forward. Now, what a lot of people do with traditional scoring is they will race to 100 points. That is absolutely, I'm a huge fan of host rules. That is absolutely something you can adjust. You can play to 50 points, you can play to 75 points, you can play 200 points, you can play to whatever you want, depending on how long you want to be sitting there playing the game. Now, the next thing we're going to talk about is another variation I've heard of that people want. If they want to have a marathon Crokinole match, they will use what I would call traditional scoring extended. So what they would do, in the examples I just used, when the black button team ended up with 15 points, so they're 15-0 on the scoreboard, the next round, the red team gets 15 points. At that point, rather than saying, okay, it's 15-15, what they would instead do is say the red points that were just scored cancel out the black points from the first round, and now it is 0-0. So in essence, what it means is one team has to win by a full 100 points if that's what they choose to race to. I would caution you with this that, yeah, you may want to pack a lunch. You could be there for a while, especially with two evenly matched opponents or teams. It could take a long, long time for one team to be that far ahead in a match. So there's your basics of traditional scoring. Now, there's what is called the NCA scoring, the National Crokinole Association scoring. Again, we're right back to the basics of 5, 10, 15, and 20 points that are scored at the end of the round. That remains the same. I have never ever seen any scoring system other than 5, 10, 15, and 20. If you have and you want to play with it, that's cool. But from my experience, my entire life of playing, that's the only point scoring system I have ever heard of. So, using that same point scoring system, the way NCA rules works is that every round is worth 2 points. If you win the round, you get 2 points. If you lose the round, you get 0 points. If you tie the round, meaning each team has a 20, or each team has a 15, it doesn't matter. If they add up so they have the exact same score, each team or opponent would score 1 point. Now, there are pros and cons to this. Where it comes from is, let's say when you are ready to have an awesome day, an awesome experience, and you sign up for an NCAA tournament, you're going to see that there are a good number of matches going on. A smaller tournament might have 10 or 15 or 20 matches going on. You go to the World Championships, there's literally 124 boards in action all at the same time. Think about that. If we use traditional scoring at the World Championships, you'd have one game that was done in one round. One player would obliterate the other player, score 100 points in one round, they're done. They're sitting in the corner twiddling their thumbs because three tables over, there's a really even match that they're only getting ahead by 5 points each round. They could be there for an hour and a half for one player to reach that 100 point barrier, or even if it was a smaller barrier, it could still take a very long time to get there. So in order to keep a tournament functional, we need to have an even amount of time that gets used per match. So with the NCAA scoring, what we do is we play 4 rounds. Each round is worth 2 points. So one player could end up winning 8-0, they could end up 7-1, 6-2, 5-3, and yes, they could even end up tied 4 points each. That was one of the questions we recently got. With NCAA scoring, after 4 rounds, couldn't you end up 4 each, which is a tie, which some people say is like kissing your sister? We don't want that. But the truth is, and again, in an NCAA, the way the NCAA works in a tournament is that you will play, let's say you play a 10-game round robin, you accumulate your points after 10 games, the players with the most points are going to move into the A pool or the B pool or the C pool, depending on how it works out. So yes, each of those players in the case of a tie will put 4 points down on their scorecard, and that's what they move forward with. In that situation, we do not want to use a tiebreaker because one, time, and two, then that person has the opportunity to score. They have an extra round to score points. It just completely messes up the math. So that's one of the benefits of the NCAA, is it just makes a tournament way more functional. The other benefit of an NCAA scoring system is that it leads to more players going after what we would call circus 20s, or these amazingly flashy shots that you will see, because there's no point in shooting to minimize the damage. When you're late in the round, you will go for that absolute Hail Mary of a shot, because even if you blunder it, you've only lost 2 points. It's not like you're looking at it going, well, if I play it safe, they're only going to gain 25 points on me in this round. That gets completely taken off the table, and everybody is shooting for the stars. And it leads to just amazing highlight reels that Nathan at Crokinole Center can turn into an amazing montage of fantastic shots. The only downside, as I see it, is that you can end up with a tie. So in an NCAA tournament, there's nothing you can do about that. But when you play at home, there are people that play this way at home. There's people that even play this way in their clubs, because it's up to you. You can do whatever you want. What a lot of people will do in those situations is they will race to an odd number of points. Our friends at the Extra Pint Club in Voorheesville will race to 5 points, and you can do that in 3 rounds. That's what I don't like about it, is sometimes if you race to 5 points, it can be done in 3 rounds, which means one team or player got hammer twice and the other team or player only got to have hammer once. So I really like to see the full 4 rounds played. But you can do a race to 5, you can do a race to 7, 9, 11, you can pick any number you want, and you can race to that score. The way we do it in our house, and this is by no means the be-all and end-all, so much of what we do when we sit down, when me and Reed sit down and play, or we play doubles, we play it exactly like it's going to be in the tournament, because that's what we're practicing for, is we're practicing for that situation. So if we play and after 4 rounds we're tied 4-4, we just call it a tie and we move on and we play our next game. But what we also do, because again, we want to replicate as much as possible, we want our practice to mirror competitive situations, our very last match that we'll play, like we'll sit down and play a few games and then somebody will say, you know what, one more game and then I think I've had enough. So we go, cool, let's do a race to 9. And that's kind of our final. And the way we do it is we don't even keep score on pen and paper, but we just kind of keep a mental tally. Whichever team or whichever player has the losing record so far that day, that player will start the race to 9 match. So it's kind of like, that's your punishment, if you will, for not playing as well that day, that you're giving the stronger player, the player that did better, the upper hand for that finals match. And in that case, when we race to 9, there's no chance of a tie. There's no chance of kissing your sister. We settle it once and for all, who is the king of Crokinole for that day. But that's just how we do it, and I'd encourage you to make up whatever host rules you want, as long as everybody knows when it starts, start with the end in mind. As long as everybody knows what the rules are when you start, it should be fun for everyone. So really hope that helped. I know it gets back to some very, very basic stuff with your point scoring, but like I say, with more and more new players, hopefully those players will find this helpful, and maybe some of these scoring options will give you some options to mix things up and just add more flavor and fun and variety to your next Crokinole match. Really hope this helps. Again, keep those questions coming, and maybe your question will be featured in a future video. Make it a great day.